I'm going to test this circuit board of a mini split air conditioner. This has come to us for repair. It was taken to another repair workshop before coming to us for repair. This circuit does not have its IGBT installed. It has been removed from this circuit, but I don't know why. After that, the IPM is installed here. Looking at the soldering pads of the IPM, it shows that soldering has been done, which means that either the IPM has been removed from the circuit for checking, or a new IPM has been installed in this circuit. The person who worked on this knows better about it. First of all, I will check if there is any issue with its fuse. I have set my multimeter to continuity mode. The fuse is perfectly fine. I am also inspecting the circuit physically to see if there is any visible physical damage. Here, the PTC sensor is installed. To check the PTC sensor, I will set the multimeter to ohm mode. I have placed the probes on the PTC pins. The PTC thermistor is showing a reading of approximately 50 ohms. This means that this PTC sensor is completely fine. Now, I will check these capacitors. These two capacitors are connected in parallel. Parallel means that if we test one of them, it will be as if we have tested both at the same time. I will set the multimeter to continuity mode. When I join the probes, the multimeter beeps. This means that the multimeter is working correctly. I will place the multimeter probes on the capacitor pins. The capacitor blocks DC voltages. Now I will switch the sides of the probes and check the capacitors again. If the capacitor blocks DC voltages both times, it means that both capacitors are okay. These are electrolytic capacitors, which block DC and allow AC to pass. If the DC voltages are blocked, it means the capacitor is functioning properly. To protect these capacitors, a resistor is installed here. Let's check if this resistor is okay or faulty. I will set the multimeter to ohms mode to check this resistor. I have placed the probes on the resistor's pins. It is showing the correct value of 0.4 ohms. Yes, this resistor is also fine in this circuit board. Since this circuit board has come from another workshop, I need to be very careful while working on it. I will have to thoroughly check each component because there must be a reason why this circuit wasn't fixed at the other workshop. Now I will check the bridge rectifier as I'm going step by step. To check the bridge rectifier, I have set the multimeter to diode mode. The side with the cut on the bridge rectifier is the positive pin side, and the other side is the negative. I will place the positive probe of the multimeter on the positive pin and the negative probe on the negative pin. In this polarity, we should not get any reading on any pin. Now, I will switch the sides of the probes. I will place the negative probe on the positive pin and the positive probe on the negative pin. In this polarity, the multimeter will show a voltage drop. Checking any pin will show a reading, indicating a voltage drop. This means that the bridge rectifier is working perfectly fine. The IGBT is not present in this circuit. Next, I will check this diode. I will place the probes on the diode pins. The side with the black probe is the cathode, which is the negative pin. The side with the red probe is the anode, which is the positive pin. The diode is showing a voltage drop, which means it is working perfectly fine. Now let's properly check the IPM. I will place the negative probe on the negative pins and the positive probe on the positive pin. The multimeter shows a reading and then stops. Now I will check the other pins in the same way. There is no voltage drop on any other pins. Now I have switched the probe sides. The positive probe is on the negative pins and the negative probe is on the positive pin. In this polarity, it shows a voltage drop. It is showing a 0.523 voltage drop. It might show a higher voltage drop depending on the type of IPM installed on the circuit board. The next pins of the IPM should also show approximately the same values. One pin shows a voltage drop of 0.453, and the next pin shows the same voltage drop. The following pin also has the same voltage drop. This means that all three IGBTs in the IPM are functioning properly. There are six IGBTs in the IPM, but when checking, it only shows three. I have installed a new IGBT in the circuit. I haven't cut the extra pins left after soldering it. I will cut these pins, and then we will check if the circuit board is working properly or if there are still any issues. Now this circuit board is ready for testing. I will test this outdoor circuit board without the indoor circuit board first. After that, I will also check this outdoor circuit board together with the indoor circuit board. There are three LED lights on this circuit that indicate errors. Now I will power on the circuit. The lights turned on and then went off. If these lights do not indicate an error after some time, then the circuit is working perfectly fine. After this, I will check the circuit board again when it communicates with the indoor unit to see if it shows any errors. I have now connected the indoor unit to the outdoor unit's circuit board. I have also connected an analyzer to the circuit. Let's understand if there is any problem with it. I will now plug the electric plug into the power socket and turn on the air conditioner. The light has turned on and the switching has occurred. The indoor unit is running. You can see that the unit has started. All the IGBTs in the IPM have turned on and off. The compressor has given a few jerks, and the outdoor fan is running. The LED lights on the outdoor circuit board have started blinking. Let's see what this blinking error means. LED 1 and 2 are blinking, while LED number 3 is stable. This indicates that there might be an F1 error in this circuit. It will keep running for some time, and after a while, it will display an error on the display. After waiting for some time, the display started showing the F1 error. Now we will understand the IPM, its pins, and the voltages that should be present on these pins. Let's start with pin number 1. Pin number 1 is empty. Pins 2, 3, and 4 are bootstrap pins. These pins are used to check for under and over voltages, and they also help detect the position of the compressor drive. Three capacitors are connected in series with these pins, and the U, V, and W pins are also associated with them. When the compressor starts, these pins detect the position of the compressor drive. In case of under or over voltage, signals are sent to the microcontroller through pin number 14 so that the IPM can be shut down. Next are pin numbers 5, 6, and 7. These three pins are used for the high DC voltages that come to the IPM, which are used to drive the high voltage IGBTs. These pins should have voltages ranging from 2.5 to 5 volts. After that, pin number 8 of the IPM is connected to the positive voltages. This pin should have positive voltages, typically around 15 volts. After this, the 9 number pin is empty. Pin number 16 is not connected. Next, let's talk about pin numbers 10, 11, and 12. These three pins provide a low negative supply. They are used to turn on the low side IGBTs in the IPM. Pin number 13 is used for the negative supply to operate the IC within the IPM. This pin, along with pin number 8, is connected in series with the IC. As I mentioned earlier, pin number 14 is used for fault detection. Pin number 15 is used for current detection. There is an IC used here for current detection that works in conjunction with the IPM. This IC is a dual operational amplifier that measures how many amperes the IPM is drawing. As previously mentioned, pin number 16 has already been covered. Some IPMs have a pin number 17, while others do not. This pin is connected to an NTC thermistor, which continuously monitors the IPM's temperature. If the temperature of the IPM exceeds 100 degrees, the IC inside the IPM sends signals to the fault detection pin, which is pin number 14. This pin then forwards these signals to the microcontroller. And then the microcontroller is responsible for turning off the IPM because the IPM cannot shut down directly. The entire control is managed by the microcontroller. I found a small fault here. Let me show you. When I followed the pins to see where each one goes, I found that a few capacitors are connected to these pins. These capacitors are used for filtering and boosting voltages. However, two capacitors are missing. These two capacitors should be present here. There are three capacitors for high voltages and three capacitors for low voltages. The circuit problem might be due to these missing capacitors. I have added new capacitors, but unfortunately, I made a mistake. When I was checking the voltages on pin number 8, the two pins accidentally touched each other. The problem that occurred afterward is that Zener diode number 7 has short-circuited. The microcontroller has also started to heat up, which is not a good sign. Now I will check this diode. In diode mode on the multimeter, the voltage drop is showing 0. I will also check it by reversing the probes. It still shows 0 voltage drop. Also, 0 voltage drop is shown after placing the probe on this IC pin. The Zener diode is showing okay with this pin of the IC, but showing 0 voltage drop with the next pin, so it has been confirmed that this diode is short-circuited. What happened is that when these two pins short-circuited, the microcontroller also short-circuited. I have removed the diode from the circuit, and there is no issue with the diode itself. When the points of these diodes are shorted, it indicates that the microcontroller has shorted. This is the diode I removed from the circuit, and it's completely fine. The pads of the diodes are short-circuited. Along with this, the capacitors are also short-circuited, and they are connected to the microcontroller. When this happens, it means the microcontroller has short-circuited. So this circuit board cannot be repaired now. Initially, it was working properly with a minor issue, but the problem has become significant due to the mistake made during the checking process. If you are willing to support the channel, you can buy me coffee. For that, visit Patreon. Click on the left or right thumbnail to watch our next videos and subscribe. Thank you.